On Tuesday, President Biden and Vice President Harris traveled to Atlanta, Georgia, urging Congress to pass voting rights legislation. Let's take a look.
Senate Republicans have exploited arcane rules to block these bills. The American people have waited long enough. The Senate must act.
I believe that the threat to our democracy is so grave that we must find a way to pass these voting rights bills. Debate them. Vote. Let the majority prevail. And if that bare minimum is blocked, we have no option but to change the Senate rules, including getting rid of the filibuster for this.
But in between lobbying for voting rights, Biden joked, "You think I'm kidding? It seems like yesterday, the first time I got arrested," seemingly referring to a claim he had previously made that he was once arrested during a civil rights movement demonstration, which Biden himself later recanted. Co-host of the Useful Idiots podcast and host of the Katie Halper Show rebuked this lie on Twitter, saying Joe Biden lies once effing again about getting arrested, which he never was. The shameless craven gall to lie in front of a Morehouse audience and to taint the legacy of those he mentions who died fighting for the right to vote. The non-right-wing media says nothing, of course. Katie Halper joins us now. Katie, welcome.
Hi, thanks so much for having me.
He just forgot, right? He just forgot.
I mean, yeah, this is so unbelievable. You can't make it up. A friend actually said to me this morning, he can't be stopped unless it comes to doing something progressive about Joe Biden, which I think is probably a good way of putting it. But yeah, I mean, I was a little bit surprised, but I guess that makes me naive. But he once again, because he can't be stopped, he once again lied about his own experience. And this is an incredibly racialized history, obviously, as he's pointing out, as he should. You know, the voting rights are a very racialized issue. It's a question of racial justice. Disenfranchisement, obviously, is a question of racial justice. And he has the kind of like gall to go in there to speak at this historically black college, Morehouse, and also, you know, praise people. Like, he mentions Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney, and I just wanted to quote what he says. So he says, I mean, he's radically honest for him, but this is just because it's just such, would require such time travel, so he doesn't lie about this. But he does say, "We saw freedom riders of every race, leaders of every faith, marching arm in arm. I did not live the struggles of Douglas, Tubman, King, Lewis, Goodman, Cheney, Schwerner." Goodman, Cheney, and Schwerner are the three civil rights voter registration organizers who were brutally murdered in Mississippi. Countless others, known and unknown. "I did not walk in the shoes of generations of students who walked these grounds, but I walked other grounds because I'm so damn old. I was there as well. You think I'm kidding, man? Seems like yesterday the first time I got arrested." Anyway, he never got arrested. He managed he was stopped while traveling in South Africa. It was apartheid South Africa. He lied. I mean, he lied and put Andrew Young, the former ambassador, in a very awkward position because he recounted how he was with him and got arrested at visiting Nelson Mandela. It turned out he didn't ever get arrested visiting Nelson Mandela. Here, once again, he has the nerve to invoke the legacy of these three men, Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney, as well as, of course, other people who he points out. I mean, he's a little bit better, I guess, than Trump in that he doesn't say that Frederick Douglass is doing a great job. But he probably would say that at another appointment about how much he helped Frederick Douglass or something. But this is also someone who has a very racist history in the Senate, right? Like, he brags about having every major minor crime bill has the name of this senator from Delaware on it. And here he is presenting himself as some kind of civil rights hero. He never was arrested. He backed very racist legislation. He never protested meaningfully. He admitted that because he said he did, and then he had to walk that back. What he did do was act as a lifeguard at a pool that was integrated, and he dealt there with Corn Pop, famously, as he recalled, a very bad dude. And that in itself is a story full of kind of racist tropes of the thuggish, predatory young black male. And I think that story has served to, he kind of tried to present himself as a negotiator, someone who was able to negotiate with black people, you know, because apparently they got into a fight about, like, one of them called the other one Esther Williams, said the other one looked like Esther Williams. but they were able to make their peace. So the whole thing is just the lies, the pandering, despite a very racist history. It's like, it's kind of like Trump's upside down Bible meets Hillary's hot sauce in her pocketbook.
Yeah, and this can't be blamed on his sundowning either, because it's a lifelong issue for him. In his 1988 presidential campaign, which he dropped out of after not gaining any traction because he was caught plagiarizing a Scottish politician's speech that saying that thousands of generations of Bidens had worked in the mines. It's like
mines, right?
You just outed yourself here because you haven't been here for thousands of generations.
Right. But yeah.
So putting all that aside, in that 88 campaign, he also inflated his civil rights record, and his staff would constantly tell him, "You've got to stop saying this. You didn't do this stuff." And he would keep saying it anyway. And finally, in the New York Times, like, did some piece in like 89 or whatever, dissecting what he actually did, and it was basically nothing. And in his memoir, he really does finally cop to not having done much of anything. It appears that it's very likely that he was at a black church service one night, and from there, the congregation marched to a movie theater where there was a sit-in going on. There was a desegregation protest happening, and it does appear that he walked with them. So yeah, he has inflated that to now being arrested as part of the civil rights movement after it being debunked multiple times.
Has he ever been arrested for anything, ever?
I mean, I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't think so. I mean, can you imagine? It would be the end of, we'd never hear the end of it unless it was for something like, you know, I don't know, like loitering or something, in which case we'd never hear about it. But anything actually righteous.
I mean, he could easily have been, because John Lewis for years would do civil disobedience where he would get arrested. Joe Crowley, because he was facing a contest from AOC, went and got arrested with John Lewis at an immigrant rights protest.
But still good. Yeah,
it was too little, too late.
That's hilarious. He was like, I was there with John Lewis getting arrested back in the day, five days ago.
He tried and failed because the cops outside the immigration facility refused to arrest them all, and it was like 100 degrees, and Crowley was like about to faint, and he went to a bar to drink water and cool down. But
He was at a bar. Actually, it was a sit-in, Ryan. That's what you don't know.
He was sitting down
at a bar.
He made the effort. He did make the effort.
I'm going to try to give Joe Biden the benefit of the doubt. And maybe what he means by arrested is just stopped, right?
So that's what he eventually said.
That's what I tried to say in South Africa, right?
Yeah.
I never realized it until you said it. Now I get, I thought he was just like, I was arrested. No, I got stopped. I never realized that the genius in his actually pretending arrest meant literally to physically arrest someone, as in to stop them. That's good, Kim. You're good.
Yeah.
You're a much more charitable woman than I. But let's say, let's give him the benefit of the doubt. Let's say he's speaking poetically. I mean, this is as much about the media, this story, as it is about Biden. And it's just despicable that you have to go to, we're really going to cede this entire beat to the Washington, Washington Express?
Examiner.
Very right-wing newspaper. Like, they're the only people who are going to be reporting on this? This is where you have to go?
Yeah, that's the way it goes. Yeah.
I mean, imagine if Trump had said something like this, as misleading as this, and as hypocritical. I mean, it would be headlines nonstop, but because it's Biden.
Yeah, the question, well, if it was Trump, though, would the Washington Examiner be covering it?
Oh, no, of course. Sorry. That goes without say. I guess I'm speaking to the... No, I'm sure they wouldn't be. They'd be talking about what a great job he did or something. But I guess I'm just speaking to the absolute... the betrayal that has been committed by all media to the left of Fox, basically. All journalism. Yeah, right. Yeah. Betrayal in both directions, of course, right. So both sides are incredibly selective and partisan, but it's just stunning.
And meanwhile, they're pretty brutal on him around Afghanistan, around the economy, around all sorts of other things. It's kind of a bizarre dichotomy that we're watching here. But, you know, Katie, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
And we'll have more Rising right after this.